Here we will be discussing common earthquake retrofit strategies that are not very effective but commonly found. The American Society of Home Inspectors Golden Gate chapter provided most of the photographs used here. I don't think it will take much imagination for you to see why this retrofit strategy will not be particularly effective. If you go under your house and you see how the middle portions of your floor are supported, you will see this. These are called posts and beams. Many contractors and engineers worry about the post-to-beam connection. The building code only requires a positive connection. A positive connection means a few nails. This is true for homes that are built as of today, right on top of an earthquake fault. This is not considered to be an important connection. The idea behind this is, if the beam were to move back and forth, let's say it moves 3 feet or 2 feet, so that the post collapses, that means the rest of the house has already slid off the foundation. For that reason, only concentrate on attaching your house to the foundation. Here's an example of a strategy to connect the post to the beam with a large piece of steel. This was either specified by an engineer or developed by a contractor. In any event, it was an unnecessary expense, and the money spent here could have been used more effectively elsewhere. Here is a construction drawing made by a structural engineer who was working for the California Earthquake Authority when they had a program called the SAFER program, which gave details to homeowners to help them retrofit their homes and make them more earthquake resistant. The chart below is from the manufacturer's catalog and specifies exactly what these connections are that the engineer is recommending. Notice that at the bottom of the chart it says connectors are not load rated, meaning they do not resist earthquakes. So if a homeowner were to do as the engineer recommended, he would spill a great deal of money to no effect. I think it's probably obvious that the nails should have been driven into the wood stud behind the plywood. This would not have happened if the contractor had experience building shear walls or if the building inspector had done a thorough inspection. This is what we call an earthquake warning device. When the earthquake pushes the joist to the right, as shown by the red arrow, the beam, which is stationary because it's bolted to the foundation where you can't see it to the right, and bolted to the floor up at the top, will push itself through the floor and let you know that an earthquake has indeed occurred. This slide is so we can have a quick review of the different ways to make the plywood to mudsill connection. If you'll recall, if we don't do something, some sort of framing modification, the plywood, as shown on the left, will simply sit on top of the mud sill and not be connected to the bolt. As you can see on the right, one way to fix this is by installing blocks in between the 2x4 studs and then nailing the plywood into the blocks. Another method is to cut the mud sill flush, as you can see on the left with the studs, and then nail the plywood directly into the mud sill. This connection is discussed in great detail in part 3 of this video series. This is a photograph that shows where some plywood was installed on a shear wall and not attached to the mud sill with blocking or flush cut or any other method. Even though the nailed blocking method has never been tested, the blocks tend to split upon time of installation, The blocks cannot be inspected after installation. And the plywood, as it rocks up and down, will try to pull the blocks up off of the foundation. This retrofit strategy is commonly found. For example, it is recommended in the International Existing Building Code. This is primarily due to the fact that these building codes are written by building officials and sometimes engineers who have never designed or installed a retrofit. I was on an International Code Council committee that developed some guidelines for the San Francisco Bay Area called Standard Plan A. In the end, these guidelines ended up using the nailed blocking method to attach the plywood to the mudsill. This was in spite of the fact that, while doing research for the committee, I was able to get an evaluation by the chief research engineer for the American Plywood Association, in which he stated that of all the methods possible, the nailed blocking method was the worst. In case you are not aware, the American Plywood Association houses the research laboratory that tests all shear walls and develops building codes. If you were to look at this plywood from the other side, you would think that these nails had been shot into blocks on top of the mudsill. In this case, the contractor was either incompetent or he was trying to deceive someone. It is interesting to note that the contractor did absolutely nothing wrong here because there's no retrofit building code that would require that he attach the plywood to the mudsill at all. This is a different house, but of obviously the same problem, and this shows exactly how common this is. Hopefully I've taught you enough by now that you can see why this retrofit strategy will not be very effective. Some contractors have quite an imagination. I don't know if you remember, but in our video on no cripple wall retrofits, we discussed how the Simpson FJA has almost no ability to resist earthquakes. This construction detail comes from a structural engineer who obviously did not understand how earthquake forces work and how to retrofit a house. That's why it's important. Just because someone is a contractor or an engineer does not mean they know what they're doing. Here is a construction detail from the most recent edition of the International Existing Building Code. It shows a 7x3/8x9 plate, which is from a hardware manufacturer that has not existed for the last 10 years. Now, one of the things I do want to point out is that those angle irons and those other strategies that are ineffective, these were all approved by the building department because there's no retrofit building code. And that's why it's very important for you to educate yourself. The building department's not going to protect you. The Federal Emergency Management Agency's not going to protect you. You have to protect yourself. And the purpose of this series of videos is to make sure you come armed so that when you buy your retrofit, you get exactly what you need for a reasonable price.